Let's get started.
Surely you won't mind.
we do have some clips we need to watch. I want to remind us, though, of, if I can, if I have a dry erase marker. Of the history, because Nietzsche makes a lot more reference to history here than he did. I mean, he did in the attempt at self-criticism, a preface to The Birth of Tragedy, but then, you know, we've relied on some extra textual information. So Nietzsche refers to Wagner as a 48er, as part of the generation of 1848. So we need to know what that's about. And I think that we've talked about those, just plotting out our thinkers. We see 1830, we'll figure next time when we do Lukács, The Theory of the Novel. So our first few thinkers, were all roughly contemporaneous with the revolutions of the late 18th century, the American and French revolutions. We jumped with Nietzsche into the late 19th century, into the period of high modernism after the Franco-Prussian War, which is what he mentions in the preface, the attempt at self-criticism in The Birth of Tragedy. The period between Franco-Prussian War and World War I, that's the period of high modernism. But the birth of modernism in the middle of the 19th century, in the middle of the 1800s, circa 1840, so we've talked about that. And, you know, maybe the most famous figure of 1848 for subsequent history is Karl Marx. Marx and Engels write the Communist Manifesto, published it in 1848, right before the revolutions break out, but in anticipation of them. And then we've talked about Baudelaire, who's another figure of 1848. But in the realm of music, Wagner. Wagner is also formed at this moment. Now, mostly 1848 revolution, that moment is referenced with France, the French Revolution of 1848. But there was a German Revolution in 1848 as well, a little bit later, 48-49. And Marx participated, Marx and Engels participated in that revolution, but that revolution failed more abjectly than the French one did. The French brought about the Second Republic and then eventually the Second Empire. In Germany, there is not a change of the state or even of the regime, so it remains a Prussian monarchy. The Prussian Empire and the unification of Germany happens in the aftermath of the Franco-Prussian War. But the figure to keep in mind, Bismarck, the Iron Chancellor, who's the great statesman of this period of time prior to and also early contemporary of Nietzsche, he is famous for saying the great issues of the day, the great political questions, will not be solved as they attempted to solve them in 1848 by popular assemblies and grand orations, grand speeches, but by iron and blood. Right, by force, by the force of the state. Not iron and blood in terms of international war, but iron and blood vis-a-vis the state and its own people. Right. So he's the Iron Chancellor. He's also famous for consolidating. He orchestrates the unification of Germany in the Franco-Prussian War. And then he also famously said,
I've been called a Democrat, a conservative, a liberal, a socialist, a reactionary, you know, a monarchist. I've been called all these things. I am all these things and none of these things. I just do what God tells me to do, basically. I just reach for the hem of God's garment as he passes by. So I do what's necessary. Doesn't matter if there's no ideology, it's just what's necessary. But he's a kind of a modernizer figure in terms of the German state. But under Prussian leadership, so we'll see what Nietzsche has to say about that. He puts Wagner in the generation of 1848 specifically as a bohemian. So Wagner, as the first modernist in music, he's a bohemian. He's like Marx and Baudelaire in this respect. So he's a kind of counterculture figure. He's someone who's emerging out of the wake of Romanticism. So if we keep in mind our sort of art historical periods. And so Classicism, Romanticism, Modernism. Wagner is the great first modernist musician, and we'll also see realism is a parallel outgrowth of Romanticism, related to but distinct from Modernism and preceding Modernism to a certain extent. So the theory of the novel, Lukács, will be focused on the bourgeois novel as it had developed from the Renaissance up through the kind of culmination of the novel as an art form in realism in the early 1800s. And then Lukács, who's writing later, he's writing around the time of World War I, is going to address modernism in the novel as a kind of terminus or a crisis, but also a kind of ending of the novel. And that's via Dostoevsky at the very end of the theory of the novel. Okay. So, again, Nietzsche is writing in the period of high modernism, but he's looking back at its origins in the middle of the 1800s, and Wagner as a kind of pioneer figure in the realm of music. So Nietzsche is a musician. I'm not going to make any great claims for how good of a musician or composer Nietzsche was, but nonetheless, he was. So he is a practitioner and not only a critic or theorist of music. And this relationship that we started the course with of art and life, one way of thinking about it, art and life, art and culture, another way of thinking about it, Susan Buck Morse. Also art and criticism. What's the task of the artist? What's the task of the critic? What's the role of the artist? What's the role of the critic? With Hegel, philosophy and art. What's the relationship between philosophy and art? And philosophy understood in a broad sense, not just a kind of formal philosophy like capital P philosophy, the discipline of philosophy, like the academic discipline of philosophy, but also the philosophy in the sense that anyone with an academic degree gets a doctor of philosophy, a PhD. Right? So what would it mean to be a doctor of philosophy in art history? Right? This is an art history course. It's art history, theory, and criticism. So what does it mean to say that there's a philosophy of art theory, art history, art criticism? There is. You know, it's a specialized subfield. It's a science. It's a humanistic science. Like all the academic disciplines are meant to be conducted scientifically. We're supposed to produce some kind of objective knowledge of these domains of activity, of human activity, and the history of these human activities. So a tension between art and philosophy, but nonetheless a reciprocal complementarity between the two. So Hegel said, with Romanticism, you could see it as the loss of the self-evidence of art. But you could also see it as a gain in consciousness of art and consciousness of aesthetic experience. Right, so the Romantics are bemoaning the fact that art's meaning and art's experiential content, these are no longer self-evident to people, but they need a reflective apparatus. They need art history, art criticism, art theory, art philosophy to make sense of what they experience in the artwork. So they do have an experience, but it's meaning and it's truth. Its meaning and the truth of its meaning are not self-evident anymore. They need to be supplemented with theorizing, with a kind of outside perspective on them. So with the birth of tragedy, which was very much inspired by Wagner, right? The birth and death of tragedy and the rebirth of tragedy that comes potentially with Wagner, according to Nietzsche, or is heralded by Wagner. The restoration of the Dionysian dimension of art. Nonetheless, that case that Nietzsche made with the birth of tragedy did depend on this opposition between art and theoretical man, art and philosophy and science.
Super quick clarification. Did you, when you said like meaning not being self-evident anymore and needing art history, was that the romanticism or like high modernism?
Romanticism. Okay. Romanticism, right. So one way of thinking about modernism is because Nietzsche, certainly in The Birth of Tragedy, and we will also see that Lukács next week, they are going to be understanding modernism also in terms of romanticism, right? So the distinction between modernism and romanticism has yet to be clarified. Now, Nietzsche is going to make an attempt at clarifying it, right? So romanticism would say, oh, we've lost art. And then Nietzsche in The Birth of Tragedy would say, oh, yes, but this has been thousands of years the case. You know, maybe there were little moments like in the Renaissance, you know, Raphael, right, the naive artist. But art might have died, but it can be reborn. And here's Wagner, right? But that whole notion of a rebirth of art is in romantic terms. You know, meaning Wagner is surpassing, transcending this division between art and theoretical man. He is reinventing music, rediscovering music, reconnecting with the truth of music. So remember The Birth of Tragedy out of the spirit of music, the idea that music was particularly Dionysian in character, which is not to say that other art forms are not Dionysian, but the Apollonian one-sided view of art, the partial view of art that Nietzsche thought was distorting and that we get from theoretical man, leans on the plastic arts as a model and can't really account for, like, you know, when Aristotle theorizes drama, tragedy, he theorizes it as an object. And he's looking at it from the outside and he's saying, okay, what is this form? And the form is being addressed from the outside rather than from within the experience of it. Right? Music, harder to do that, like music has to be experienced in the moment, if you will, not looked at distantly, theoretically. That's what theory means. Let's always keep that in mind. Theory means our perspective on things, what it looks like, theoria. So theoretical man doesn't inhabit the truth, but looks at it from the outside. It's external, it's objective, rather than subjective. Music, it's harder to look at from the outside. Now, of course, you can, right? So we do have an experience of music that is objectifiable, were we just talking about this, about listening to music before going to see it performed live, right? The peculiarity of that is, you know, so if you go to see, you know, because we're kind of ruined for music by pop music, right? We're totally ruined in our ability to experience music by pop music. And so we don't have, like, I don't know, the attention span. I don't even know how to describe it, you know? So it helps us to actually be in the moment of a musical performance, especially a classical musical performance, to listen to the piece ahead of time so that you almost have like a map for it going into it, right? And so what we will lose in that kind of experience, when we listen to a recording before seeing a live performance, especially of like an opera or a symphony or something like that, but you know, like any kind of chamber music as well. Now, in the past, so of course people could hear folk songs and they could hear church music over and over and over again, but art music, you probably would only hear once. And that would be it, right? So when we listen to a recording ahead of a performance that was meant to be experienced once in that moment, what we're doing is trying to objectify it to ourselves so that we can experience it. Otherwise, it would be sort of too overwhelming, right? We wouldn't be able to like track our own experience of it. We wouldn't be able to subjectively experience it in the Kantian sense of reflecting as we're in it. Right, so the way that we are able to step outside of it is to listen to a recording of it beforehand, which you can sort of pause and you can rewind, you can do all those great things with it in a way that, of course, the live performance you can't. All right, so you can kind of study it and then listen to it. All right, so that would be evidence of Hegel's point, right, which is that we need that, right? We need these separate moments as opposed to one moment. That was not really the case for Kant. So anyway, Nietzsche thought, well, that sucks, and you know, he's kind of romantic, and Wagner is romantic, and Wagner restores the in-the-moment quality of the experience of music. I mean, it's a curious thing. So, you know, classicism, we have that in the visual arts, but let's think about it just in terms of that term I used, classical music. Classical music. What do we even mean by classical music? Well, we actually mean something very like specific in terms of a historical interval. We're basically talking about Mozart to Beethoven, like classical music, classical Western tonality, right? There's this sort of moment. And of course, this helps us, you know, again, all Germans all the time, all Krauts all the time, Mozart and Beethoven. Okay, so music, it can make a claim to being like German, like the Germans are great at music, Mozart and Beethoven, and then Wagner comes along. Beethoven is a kind of a figure that straddles classicism and romanticism. So the late Beethoven is a kind of early kind of romantic, right? So it helps that way. Now, interestingly, if we were to map Mozart and Beethoven onto our timeline vis-a-vis the philosophers,
Mozart would be more where Kant is, and Beethoven would be more where Hegel is. And interestingly, Mozart would also be a kind of, he would be a kind of Rousseau, right? So Mozart would be a kind of Rousseau to Kant kind of guy, and then Beethoven would be like a Hegel in music,
right? So like Mozart's the breakout artist, and then like Beethoven is like the fully realized exemplar of this kind of music. In the way that Kant initiated critical philosophy and Hegel completed it. But then what do you do after that, right? And that's where you get Romanticism and then Modernism, right? So modernism as, oh, we can't really do it the way Mozart and Beethoven did it, but let's try to do it. Now, I mentioned like classical music, that specific period of history. Before Mozart, things sound a little bit antiquated, sound a little old-fashioned, sound like musically idiomatic, right? You have like kind of Rococo, you have, before that, you have a kind of a Baroque music, and it sounds like it's from a different world. Mozart sounds like the beginning of our world, and Beethoven sounds fully in our world, and yet they sound like the early version of our world. Wagner then feels like more fully our world. So Wagner, I'll just mention this, he's the sort of model for, well, all subsequent music is going to be wrestling with Wagner. He's a funny model for film music. He's like the cinema soundtrack before there was cinema. And of course, he tried to produce a cinematic experience with the total work of art, right? Where he was a total control freak. He wrote the libretto, he wrote the music, he did the stage design, he directed it, he conducted it, right? It was all his creation, every detail of it, in a way that would have struck people like Mozart and Beethoven as odd, right? It would have actually been seen as contrary to the spirit of the composer. The spirit of the composer would be to compose something and really rely on the performer's interpretation of the music in order to realize it. Whereas Wagner's like, no, I have to tell you exactly how to play it. And even the way it's scored is different, right? So Mozart and Beethoven, it's a very schematic score. There's a lot of room for interpretation. Wagner, it's the beginning of the more modern, hyper-notated score that's telling you every little thing to do in the performance. Go ahead.
But is that why Nietzsche calls him a comedian?
That's a more complicated problem, right? So that's the problem of this, the drama, right? In other words, opera, like what is opera, right? Opera is a musical drama. But then the question is, well, what's the relationship between the music and the drama? Now, in The Birth of Tragedy, what's interesting is that the rebirth of tragedy actually depends on music. Right? For tragedy to be fully restored, it has to be this musical drama, and it has to be this total work of art in which you can't separate the music from the drama. But if you think about opera, so this is the supposed distinction between Italian opera and German opera. So German opera is supposedly according to the Wagnerian mold, and Italian opera is more like a series of songs. It's kind of strung together, you know, by a play, you know? Whereas, like, are there songs in Wagner? Is there a play? Is there a drama? Like, you know, it's pretty murky, the whole thing. So to call Wagner a comedian is to sort of rob Wagner of his pretenses, right? Because of course Wagner is not trying to be a comedian, he's trying to be a tragedian. But really he should be a musician, right? So what Nietzsche says about Wagner is that he has replaced music with acting. He's replaced the art of music with the art of acting. And in other words, that it's comedy in the sense that it's merely a play, and that's true of not only the play, the drama, but of the music, which is it's a weird thing that he's saying. Like, what does it mean to say he's replaced the art of music with the art of acting? In part, he's pointing back to the romantic origins of Wagner, which is to say that Wagner's modernism, which Nietzsche originally thought solved the problem of the meaning of art, is still a kind of as if, right? It's sort of pointing to something that it can't actually do. It's suggesting something that it can't actually do. and that becomes a kind of, it becomes a kind of comedy about music or a comedy about art. Like, so it becomes not a story of like cosmic existential meaning, like a kind of pseudo-religious meaning, which is what Wagner tries to do with it, kind of myth-making. It becomes rather like very much a story of Wagner in his own historical moment and human conventions, human institutions, the way comedy. So when we talked about tragedy and comedy, the tragedy is about the will of the gods, the comedy is about social conventions and social mores and social actions. Right. Tragedies are less about society and more about the will of the gods. Comedy is less about the will of the gods and more about society. So Wagner, of course, doesn't want to give us a kind of allegory of the condition of music in the 19th century. He wants to give us some like eternal other dimension kind of existential truth. But really, according to Nietzsche, he's giving us an allegory of the fate of music in the 19th century. And that's the modernism. All right, so Wagner's music is about music, but it tries not to show that. It hides that behind this kind of self-mystification. And in that way, it's a kind of dishonest modernism. And we'll see that Carmen, by contrast, is honest modernism. You know, it's reflective on itself as music. It doesn't try to hide that the way Wagner hides it. He hides it also behind the drama. Right, so listening to Wagner, ignoring this, the play, ignoring the story, ignoring the drama, you'd be like, oh, what has happened to music? Right? So the stage drama turns it into, I think he calls it like perfume, like, you know, like he has this complete flip on the significance of the music, right? So the musical kind of atmospherics just becomes a kind of hocus pocus, right? It becomes this kind of smoke on stage around the magician, right? So Wagner thought of himself as a priest. Here's another analogy that he brings. But actually he was a magician, and not a like actual magician, but like a charlatan magician, like someone who's just doing a kind of optical illusion trick, not a like mage, not like a magician, right? Not an actual sorcerer. And of course we'll see that's why the character in Parsifal, Klingsor, the evil wizard, right? The evil sorcerer is Wagner, right? Not Parsifal, but the bad guy, like that's actually the stand-in for Wagner, according to Nietzsche. So he's the one who wanted to join the Knights of the Holy Grail, but he was rejected by them. And so he tried to show his spiritual devotion by like cutting off his own penis, and they still rejected him. And so then he's like, okay, then I'm gonna destroy them. Right, so you know, and then he's got his like prostitute, fallen woman who laughed at Jesus on the cross and is condemned to wander the earth unhappily for the rest of time, Kundry, right? And so Klingsor gets with Kundry, and then Klingsor and Kundry like create the flower maidens. Right, so these are the kind of pseudo nymphs who seduce men to their deaths, right? But Kundry is like the main seductress, right? You know, again, she's like the fallen woman who gets in with the fallen man, and then Parsifal is the holy fool. That's what Parsifal means. It means the holy fool. It's like he is a kind of naive, innocent kid who has a special role to play in his ignorance, in his naivete. right, who is discovered by, well, he's discovered hunting by the Knights of the Holy Grail, who take him in, and then he's affected by one of the Knights of the Holy Grail, like, getting injured in combat with Klingzor, the forces of evil, and then he tries to avenge Amfortas. And then it goes, and then, but is seduced by Kundry, who plays on his melancholic missing his mother. So she sort of mommy seduces him. But then, you know, he's sort of repulsed, and then she has this spiritual transformation in which she goes from being a whore to being Madonna. Not Madonna or Madonna, but a Madonna, you know, the Madonna whore paradigm. And then, you know, she sort of, it becomes the sort of chastened, chaste woman who's going to spiritually redeem herself. And then Kundry is defeated by Parsifal. I mean, excuse me, Klingzor is defeated by Parsifal. Yeah. So Nietzsche's like, what is this crap? Right, what is this absurd? And then also basically, what is this weird Christianity from someone who's a self-professed pagan? Right, because Wagner, part of his modernism is that he's like, Christianity is so uncool. I'm a pagan, right? But then, of course, he's a Christian, because trying to be a pagan, being an ex-Christian who tries to be a pagan just means that you are a Christian, but you're in denial about it, right? But that comes out in this last opera, Parsifal. So he thinks that it's, like, schlocky and in bad taste, and it's, like, pseudo-moralism. It's like this kind of mythologized, like quasi-Christian, pseudo-pagan kind of nonsense that is like titillating people sexually, but also like giving this like anti-sexual message, right? This pseudo-moralistic anti-sexual message. And so he compares it to Carmen, to Bizet's Carmen. Roughly contemporaneous with Parsifal. And what makes the comparison important is actually they're both modern, they're both modernist, and they both actually at a musical level have very similar like resources in terms of sound, in terms of the orchestra that they use, in terms of there are qualities of both works that could be lost on us, that Nietzsche's, you know, thinks that it's an appropriate comparison between the two, by which he says Carmen is great and Parsifal is horrible. What's our subtitle for the case of Wagner? A philosopher's problem? A musician's problem. Wait, a musician's problem, but then he says, his thesis is, Wagner is a necessary lesson for the philosopher. Right, so it's the case of Wagner, a musician's problem, but it's a musician's problem that has to be a lesson for the philosopher. Right, so what we have here is a couple of things. So I had mentioned previously to you guys the art, philosophy, science. Distinction, right, between the subjective and the objective. Or apparently objective, apparently subjective, truth. Right, and the different ways of conceiving of this, meaning art and philosophy and science and philosophy.
right? So these groupings, right? So at first, he groups them, science and philosophy together as theoretical man, as opposed to art. So the Socrates who could play music, if you remember that. The Socrates who could dance, the Socrates who could play music. That was his aspiration. And that's what he thought Wagner was. Wagner was the Socrates who could play music, affecting the reconciliation, the reunification of art and theoretical man, or art and philosophy and science. Now he says, no, these are three different things. These are three different things. And really, it's a problem of philosophy. Meaning, what is this seeming meeting point between the objective and the subjective? Right, so, you know, we have in modern academia today, we have still the physical or natural sciences, the hard sciences or the exact sciences. We have the social sciences and we have the human sciences. So we have the humanities, social science, natural science. Right. Where's philosophy? It's in the humanities. It's in the humanities. So philosophy is nowhere near natural science, physical science. It's not with the hard and exact sciences, it's with the fuzzy stuff. It's with the humanities, the human sciences. It's also not in the social sciences. I don't know where the social sciences fit here exactly. But we could say, in general, what's the relation of all of this to society? Well, we'll leave that to one side. Right, so what's the relationship of all of this to society? Science and society, philosophy and society, art and society. Now, last time with on the genealogy of morals, he said in a self-critical way, he is a philosopher. He's going to own that. And he's not some kind of art philosopher, although he does write poetry in his philosophy. But the other term he uses is psychologist. That he's a psychologist. Well, where does psychology fit onto that one? What is psychology? Well, I guess you could call it a hard science. What's the difference between psychology and philosophy? Right? What's a psychological account of our mind versus a philosophical account of our mind? Art. Are aesthetics essentially a psychological phenomenon? In the sense of something that you could account for scientifically? So do you know where psychology is? Social science. It's in the social sciences. So psychology, like society itself, is off the map. It doesn't really fit into this framework. And that's deliberate by Nietzsche. That is deliberate. Right. And he does do a kind of psychology of Wagner and of the Wagnerians. Right, so it's a musician's problem, meaning Wagner is an authentic expression of a crisis of music. Musician's problem. That the philosopher has to learn from, and that he's going to try to address
psychologically. We could even say he's, before Freud, he's almost doing a psychoanalysis of Wagner's music, but also of the appeal of Wagner's music. Why do people like it? Do they like it? How do they like it? Is it a kind of masochistic enjoyment, Wagner? Right? So that's why, like, only the special elect people are like the Wagnerians. They're like, oh, no, Wagner can't be appreciated by the masses, only by the special initiates. And Wagner eventually even sets up a crazy place where he puts on, that's Bayreuth, that's where he makes people go on like almost a religious pilgrimage to go see his music performed. All right, so he starts out more ordinary, he's willing to put on his operas in like the town, in the cities, you know, but then he's like, no, if you want to see my work, you have to come to me, right? And people treat it like that. They treat it like, I don't know, Burning Man Festival or whatever, right? And it is like a special experience that you're having. You're going to be with the people who all are into this, right? And Nietzsche, anyway, is like, yeah, this is fucked up, and who are these crazies? So he was part of them. He was a deadhead. But then at a certain point, he like has a freak out. He describes it, right? He had some intestinal issues, Nietzsche. And so while watching a Wagner opera, he had like a bowel attack. And then he was like, it's the fucking music. That's what's doing this to me, right? So he was like, in order to preserve his physical health, he needed to like break with Wagner and Wagnerianism because it was making him physically sick. Probably not. Probably it was psychological. Again, though, right? That would demand a psychological analysis or investigation. So what's the appeal of this music? Does anyone really like it? Is it indigestible? Is it sickening, right? And people are into it. People are into it.
He says it's made for modern nerves. Yeah.
Right, modern nerves, absolutely. Right, which is gonna sound like psychiatry, which is in the hard sciences. Like it's gonna sound like neurology. But he's not saying that. He's saying nerves like nervousness, you know? Like there's a kind of anxiety that attaches to Wagner, and that listening to Wagner makes you anxious, right? And so, of course, that's why he had a bowel attack, right? So it's also because they're fucking long. And anyway, so, yeah. Sure, absolutely, of course.
They're so anxious that they just have bowel attacks.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, we're talking about one dude, though, Nietzsche, right? So he's the one who went running out of the audience and then was like, I'm never doing that again. Fuck these Wagner people. But let's think about that. Because Nietzsche is not saying that, you know, it's just him and it's just Wagner. He's saying Wagner is somehow exemplary of a state of music, a psychological state that's common to people. Right, so it's a, we, you know, modern people have a different psychology. Gets that from Baudelaire. Modern music is different. Like, so there's an art history story about the history of music that came to this point, Wagner, modernism. A history of psychology, I guess you could say, that brings us into this strange, melancholic, anxious personality. for which Wagnerian music seems appropriate in some way?
So he does think that Wagner is a symptom, but Wagner is a legitimate symptom, would you say? So let's just watch a little bit of what's the beginning of Parsifal, and then we'll switch to Carmen, and then we might switch back to some Parsifal. We're going to kind of go back and forth. But I like watching in particular the Vorspiel, the prelude.
Thank you.
are too early. I like the there's a bus that drives in. Okay, look at a couple of the songs.
Congratulations, Corporal.
All right. Let's see what Nietzsche has to say for us. So Nietzsche says, I have granted myself some small relief. It is not merely pure malice when I praise Bizet in this essay at the expense of Wagner. Interspersed with many jokes, I bring up a matter that is no joke. To turn my back on Wagner was for me a fate. To like anything at all, again, after that, a triumph. Perhaps nobody was more dangerously attached to and grown together with Wagnerizing. Nobody tried harder to resist it. Nobody was happier to be rid of it. A long story. You want a word for it? If I were a moralist, who knows what I might call it? Perhaps self-overcoming? The self-overcoming we've talked about. But the philosopher has no love for moralists. Neither does he love pretty words. What does a philosopher demand of himself, first and last? To overcome his time in himself, to become timeless. With what must he therefore engage in the hardest combat? With whatever marks him as the child of his time. So if you remember Robert Pippin from the first day of class, he said that with Hegel, you get the clearest sort of recognition that the philosopher, as everyone else, is a child of their time. Well then, I am, no less than Wagner, a child of this time, that is, a decadent. But I comprehended this, I resisted it. The philosopher in me resisted. Nothing has preoccupied me more profoundly than the problem of decadence. I had reasons. Good and evil is merely a variation of that problem. Once one has developed a keen eye for the symptoms of decline, one understands morality too. One understands what is hiding under its most sacred names and value formulas. Impoverished life, the will to the end, the great weariness, morality negates life. Let me say something about this. So morality. So morality, maybe as the opposite of morals. So morals as opposed to morality, and morals as opposed to moralists and moralism. Right, so if you remember The Truth and Lie in an Extra Moral Sense, where he talked about honesty, right? So rather than honest statements or honest actions, there's this occult quality, honesty, that is the cause of the honest act. Similarly here, it's not moral, the moral act or the immoral act, but rather morality and moralism, a kind of reification or a kind of hypostasization of the moral. Because he's not gonna say art is without any moral value. He's not going to say that, but he is going to say maybe art is the enemy of morality and of moralism and of moralists. So morality negates life, but that doesn't mean moral behavior negates life. No, but morality, again, something put outside of us, right? Submitting to morality as opposed to your own moral actions. morality negates life. Such a task, diagnosing this problem, I required a special discipline to take sides against everything sick in me, including Wagner, including Schopenhauer, including all modern humaneness. Right, so humaneness as opposed to the humane. A profound estrangement, cold, sobering up, against everything that is of this time, everything timely, and most desirable of all, the eye of Zarathustra, an eye that beholds the whole fact of man at a tremendous distance, below. For such a goal, what sacrifice wouldn't be fitting, what self-overcoming, what self-denial? My greatest experience was a recovery. Wagner is merely one of my sicknesses. So, self-denial, asceticism, the meaning of ascetic ideals. Right, he said, ascetic ideals mean one thing for the artist, another thing for the scientist, but really he was concerned with the asceticism or self-denial of the philosopher. That because the philosopher tried to put truth outside of himself, objectively, there was a kind of self-denial involved that was actually bad and harmful in a way that's not the case for the scientist or the artist. So experience, the experience of recovery, recovery from what? From a sickness, Wagner being merely one of them. It says, not that I wish to be ungrateful to this sickness. When in this essay I assert the proposition that Wagner is harmful, I wish no less to assert from whom he was nevertheless indispensable for the philosopher. Others may be able to get along without Wagner, but the philosopher is not free to do without Wagner. He has to be the bad conscience of his time. For that he needs to understand it best. But confronted with the labyrinth of the modern soul, where could he find a guide, more initiated, more eloquent prophet of the soul than Wagner? Through Wagner, modernity speaks most intimately, concealing neither its good nor its evil, having forgotten all sense of shame. And conversely, one has almost completed an account of the value of what is modern once one has gained clarity about what is good and evil in Wagner. All right, so let's unpack this a little bit. So why is the philosopher not free to do without Wagner? Because Wagner gives you a kind of access to the truth of one's time. Right? Because the philosopher has to battle with his own time in order to try to achieve, whether or not he does achieve, is another point, to try to achieve a truth that transcends his time. But he can only do that with the proper occasion for it. So notice that what he's setting up here, the relationship between art and philosophy. So the philosopher needs art. Why? Because art is the symptom of the time of the philosopher. Art expresses the pathology of the time. Art is the sickness. It's an expression of the sickness of the time and gives an access to the truth of the time in a way that maybe philosophy on its own can't access. So remember Robert Pippin, first day of class, he says, this is why art and literature become so important, because they become symptomatic, but also diagnostic. He says, I understand perfectly when a musician says today, I hate Wagner, but I can no longer endure any other music. But I'd also understand a philosopher who would declare, Wagner sums up modernity. There is no way out. One must first become a Wagnerian. All right, so what does that mean? It means that there's no way out of modernity except in and through modernity. There's no way of overcoming Wagner other than in and through Wagner. It has to be a self-overcoming. Self-overcoming of modernity, self-overcoming in and through the symptoms of modernity. So last time with
on the genealogy of morals, nihilism was the general category for the problem of modernity and also the symptoms of modernity. So what would it mean to bring that into the realm of music? A kind of nihilism in the realm of music, a kind of self-destruction of music, a will to the end of music, a will to the end of art by the artist. Yesterday, he says, I heard, would you believe it, Bizet's masterpiece for the 20th time. Right? Because unlike Wagner, who only puts on his operas at a special location, and you have to take a pilgrimage, you have to travel there to see it, you're not going to be able to see it 20 times, whereas if Carmen is having a run in your local city, then you can go night after night, you can watch it again and again. Again, I stayed there with tender devotion. Again, I did not run away. This triumph over my impatience surprises me. How such a work makes one perfect. One becomes a masterpiece oneself. Really, every time I heard Carmen, I seemed to myself more of a philosopher, a better philosopher than I generally consider myself. So patient do I become, so happy, so Indian, so settled. To sit 5 hours, the first stage of holiness. May I say that the tone of Bizet's orchestra is almost the only one I can still endure? That other orchestral tone, which is now the fashion, Wagner's brutal, artificial, and innocent at the same time. Thus it speaks all at once to the three senses of the modern soul. Brutal, artificial, and innocent. Ooh, does that characterize everything around us in our time still? It's brutal, artificial, and innocent. Yeah. Including this computer I'm reading off of. Apple product. It's brutal. It's artificial. It's innocent. Thus, it speaks all at once to the three senses of the modern soul. How harmful for me is this Wagnerian orchestral tone? And yet, we'll see, there's some similarities. I call it sirocco. I break out into a disagreeable sweat. My good weather is gone. So sirocco is the dry heat. It's like the desert wind that comes across the Mediterranean and hits southern Europe. Comes off from Africa and hits Europe. This music seems perfect to me. It approaches lightly, subtly, politely. It is pleasant. It does not sweat. What is good is light. Whatever is divine moves on tender feet. First principle of my aesthetics. This music is evil, subtly fatalistic. At the same time, it remains popular. Its subtlety belongs to a race, not to an individual. It is rich. It is precise. It builds, organizes, finishes. Thus, it constitutes the opposite of the polyp in music, the infinite melody. Have more painful, tragic accents ever been heard on stage? So the infinite melody, or the unchained melody, is the Wagnerian style. Right. That just sort of strings you along endlessly. It never quite achieves the form. Right. So remember that he liked that in The Birth of Tragedy, because it was the Dionysian dissolution of form. Now he's attacking. Have more painful, tragic accents ever been heard on the stage? How are they achieved? Without grimaces, so this is, he's switching back to talking about Carmen, without counterfeit, without the lie of the great style. Finally, this music treats the listener as intelligent, as if himself a musician, and is in this respect too the counterpart of Wagner, who was, whatever else he was, at any rate, the most impolite genius in the world. Wagner treats us as if, he says something so often, till one despairs, till one believes it. Once more, I become a better human being when this Bizet speaks to me. Also a better musician, a better listener. Is it even possible to listen better? I actually bury my ears under this music to hear its causes. It seems to me I experience its genesis,
I tremble before dangers that accompany some strange risk. I am delighted by strokes of good fortune, of which Bizet is innocent. And oddly, deep down, I don't think of it, or don't know how much I think about it. For entirely different thoughts are meanwhile running through my head. Has it been noticed that music liberates the spirit, gives wings to thought? That one becomes more of a philosopher the more one becomes a musician? The gray sky of abstraction, rent as if by lightning, the light strong enough for the filigree of things, the great problems near enough to grasp, the world surveyed as from a mountain. I have just defined the pathos of philosophy, and unexpectedly answers drop into my lap, a little hail of ice and wisdom, of solved problems. Where am I? Bizet makes me fertile. Whatever is good makes me fertile. I have no other gratitude, nor do I have any other proof for what is good. Okay, so let's focus on this. So the task of music, a criterion of the success of music, is that it makes the listener a better listener. And it makes them a listener as if they are a musician. So this is a basic criterion of art, that art should enlighten us about art. Art should enlighten us about our aesthetic experience. Art should allow us to recognize our participation in the making of the work itself. Right, so a painting is just pigment on a surface. It doesn't really become a painting until someone looks at it, until the viewer views it. A piece of music is just sounds, just noise, really, until the listener listens to it. Then it becomes music. In other words, where does the form happen? It doesn't happen in the thing. It happens in our experience. And in that experience, it should help us become aware of our experience and feel like we are active participants in the experience. That it isn't happening to us, that we are doing it. But again, the listener, listening is an activity. The viewer, viewing is an activity. The reader, reading is an activity. So good art allows us to experience that activity, educate us about that activity, allow us to feel like we're participating in the activity. And learning about ourselves in the process. Right, so every good work of art provides an aesthetic education. And would even begin to educate us about making it, making art. Inspire us to be artists. So, by contrast, Wagner does the opposite. In other words, Wagner does not allow us to feel like active participants in the listening experience. He mystifies rather than enlightens or educates. He makes music seem inaccessible and incomprehensible. Okay. There's no musical exposition. So that would have been a major criterion of bourgeois music, like classical music, Mozart and Beethoven, for example, would basically the sonata form is a form of exposition in which the music analyzes itself as it proceeds. Wagner is the opposite of that. So he used the word polyp. So polyp is something that we know from like medical usage. A polyp is like a sea coral. So coral in the ocean, how does it grow?
So it's made up of little creatures that create little burrows for themselves, and then they just sort of accrete, they just accumulate, and then the coral grows that way through the accumulation of the little animals with their little burrows, right? So it's not like a clear construction. It's this kind of semi-random, but also, you know, it assumes a kind of a pattern, but it defies any sense of form. It doesn't let you see its structure.
That's why Adorno will call it stasis in music. It doesn't suggest a kind of temporal progression.
I mean, we'll see what Adorno has to say about that, because Adorno thinks that the static quality in Parsifal in particular is actually what allows it to have a critical and enlightening function. Right, that it's that in some ways Parsifal, Nietzsche's treating Parsifal as the culmination of Wagner's work, and Adorno is going to treat it as both the culmination and a kind of reversal, so a kind of dialectical culmination of Wagner's work. So the contrast would be with the Tristan and Isolde climax that we listened to with The Birth of Tragedy.
Let's see another example. Okay, that's love. Let's look at the top of the arrow. So that's another. So with Bizet, with Carmen, you have the kind of incorporation, that's something that Nietzsche talks about, of some traditional music, but then sort of brought in and situated within the larger work. Right, so that is, I think that I gave you guys, I hope I gave you guys this. Let's see what our music selections are. Yes, so I gave you guys the prelude, I gave you guys the Love is a Bird, then we've got, oh, maybe I didn't give you that one. All right, let me give you that one. I gave you the card song, the card trio song, which we're going to have to listen to and see what Adorno says about it. And then the final scene. So let's look at the final scene. Let's see if they trash that one. It's supposed to be longer than that. This then we'll take a break. It used to be easy to find these things, but then they take them down. Let me see if this one is. This is the link that I gave you guys. That's not good. Alright. Alright, we'll take a short break, and then we'll come back. I'll try to find it during the break.
No, that's like earlier in the it's earlier in the story. So she sort of gets the premonition. So let's listen to the proper version of the same piece, because Adorno talks about it. Because there's a difference between the way they did it in the movie version and the way it was originally done. took out, they took out the other girls coming in, and so the Always Death, and then it's like, oh, shuffle the cards again. And I think that Adorno, the way Adorno puts it is that the entire history of musical theater had like come to that point, to that exact like transition, a kind of almost like a jarring montage, a kind of psychological kind of total reversal. And they interestingly took it out of the Hollywood version, the Carmen Jones version. But, you know, they just end on that note. Right. And just sacrifice the combination of the two, you know, her kind of solo and then what had come before that, where they were talking about, you know, the fortune telling through the cards. All right, so that brings us to the point that sort of bring Adorno in now. The Fantasia Sopra Carmen. So this is our first reading from Adorno that we had for this week. And he's responding to Nietzsche. Basically arguing against the grain of Nietzsche, or trying to tease out something from Nietzsche that is otherwise buried in the Nietzsche, that's implicit rather than explicit. And it's really the issue of freedom. So, so Nietzsche, in his telling of Carmen, says, you know, it's Don Jose and Carmen, or Joe and Carmen, Don Jose, that, I guess we didn't watch that scene. We didn't watch the climax of the, maybe we'll do that before we turn to this. So she predicts her own death through the cards. But then she says, I'm going to, you know, live as fiercely as possible until I die, right? So there's a strange paradox or contradiction, combination of embracing fate and freedom. All right, so she freely chooses to embrace her fate. Right, and her character, she's sort of superstitious, but she's also this free-spirited woman, and so the idea is that she's going to defy social conventions, she's going to assert her autonomy. We already saw that song. She's not going to be tied down by love. You know, she's going to follow where her heart takes her. And so she insists on her freedom, but her freedom amounts to embracing her fate, meaning was she fated to have a tragic end? You know, was that an inescapable kind of destiny for her? Maybe, maybe not, but she chooses it in any respect. Like, that is her freedom. Her freedom is to choose death instead of being unfree. So let's see this scene. This is the climax of the story. We'll deal with Nietzsche's interpretation of it and then Adorno's interpretation of it. Alright, so for Nietzsche, right, he interprets it as, oh yes, Carmen is good because it shows that you're willing to kill for love. Right, kill for love. Don Jose is going to kill Carmen instead of letting her go because he's so impassioned, he's so in love with her. Adorno turns that to not kill for love, but die for freedom.
die for freedom. Right, so there's the question of how Nietzsche poses it. He poses it in terms of identifying with the man in the story, which, of course, at a psychological level, is kind of a transparent displacement, because the main character is not the man, it's the woman, it's Carmen. It's her tragedy, but also her freedom that's at stake. So again, the paradox is that she says, you know, she'd rather die than be stuck with him after she's fallen out of love with him. And that she already had a premonition of this with the fortune telling through the cards. So, you know, Nietzsche is like, you know, kill for love, die for love. Adorno says, but what about freedom? What about Carmen's freedom? So that's really the theme of the story, is that she defies conventions, including the convention of staying with her man just because he wants it to, or wants her to. So here's Adorno. We're jumping ahead a bit. We'll come back to Adorno in a couple weeks. Everyone on the stage knows from the outset that Carmen is the heroine. It is as if they had already seen the opera. The assembled youths all ask after her when the girls from the cigarette factory come out for lunch. Surrounded by the crowd of carefree girls, they lie in wait for her alone. However, she wants nothing to do with love on this particular day. From a pure desire for freedom, the antithesis of virtue. Right, so in other words, it's not that she's rejecting the suitors because she's trying to maintain her virtue. No, she's doing it out of freedom. Right from the start, we see the operatic convention at work, which clearly distinguishes the main characters from the lesser ones. Just as the chronicler of a heroic life comforts himself and his readers for light losses in battle with the thought that only minor figures have been killed. Here, quite innocently and as it were for reasons of greater dramatic convenience, undisturbed by metaphysical preconceptions, the convention highlights the hierarchy of appearance and essence, which normally is carefully blurred. Only in the heaven of ideas that lies beyond the deep azure of the actual sky is Carmencita more important than her friends who otherwise resemble her. Of course, she does not take her incognito too seriously. Among the conspicuous crowd, she is the most conspicuous of all, a white hind among the rest of the wild game. Under interrogation, she sings instead of answering, and has only the easygoing conventions of opera to thank if this fails to give rise to a scandal. Her darting and whistling cheekiness has added the archaic pride of the simple young girl to the bourgeois repertoire, and even today a time-honored custom requires that Carmen should raise her skirts provocatively in front of the hapless sergeant, mainly at the expense of her gracefulness, which is a no less vital requirement of the role. Our attention is drawn to her as an outcast, as a woman who has not been completely domesticated, and we may doubtless accept the ensemble's judgment that Carmen began the quarrel, the childish anarchic bout of fighting, the destructive outburst which sets in motion the events which already seem to preclude a happy end, for Carmen is a gypsy. Initially, not too much is made of this, apart from her ability to sing and dance better than the native population of Seville, and the fact that her indifference goes to the head of the sergeant at whom she directed her wild gaze. Similarly, the gypsy scene in Act II remains within the operatic convention, which ever since the days of Preciosa has delighted in gypsy choruses and cannot do enough to express its envy of the colorful and unfettered lives of those who are outlawed from the bourgeois world of work, condemned to hunger and rags, and suspected of possessing all the happiness which the bourgeois world denies itself in its irrational rationality. Carmen, too, is one of these operas
of exogamy, which begins with La Juive and La Africaine, and proceed with Ida, Lakme, and Madame Butterfly to Berg's Lulu. All of them celebrate eruptions from civilization into the unknown. This is how Nietzsche understood Carmen. Many quotes. And how comforting we find the Moorish dance, how even our insatiable desire finds itself satisfied by this lascivious melancholy. Love at last, love translated back into nature, and not the love of a more exalted virgin. And without defining it explicitly, he put his finger on what separates him and Bizet most profoundly from their antipode, from the Wagnerian world of incest and the Grail community. That's the Parsifal. For in that world, love loves only what is like itself. In fact, only loves itself, and hence does not really love at all. Hence it sacrifices nature to the inferno of society, which is both invoked symbolically and glorified. The gypsy costumery is only an image in Act 3 as the tragedy draws to its close, after Carmen has refused to be reconciled to her dissatisfied lover, whom she has dragged off into a den of thieves. Upon his asking whether she no longer cares for him, she replies with a Latinate precision that sharpens each of her sentences, as if for some wholly unknown courtroom record. So much is certain, she declares, that she loves him a lot less than before, and that their relationship would be at an end if he refused to allow her the freedom to do as she pleased. The consequences would be of no concern to her. The conversation is scarcely ended when her two gypsy colleagues and fellow smugglers produce the cards, and all three set about telling each other's fortunes. The music wastes no time at all, where the ring, Wagner, laboriously unfolds dark oracles about the rolling wheel. The music here starts to roll in an allegretto on the strings as if it were a roulette wheel, and without a single word by way of commentary. Having reached A minor, the music describes a magic circle and emphasizes it with a few piercing accents, like tricks in a card game. It knows that what the cards and cutting remarks have in common is that provocation of destiny, which is nothing other than the wheel of fortune, the blindness of fate itself. All this proceeds without a break on the model of the perpetuum mobile, and only the chromatic bases ominously underscore the aimless hurly-burly. This is countered by the refrain of the two fate-like sisters in F major. They sing not like the Norns, but like the vaudeville characters, and Nietzsche doubtless had them in mind when he said of the music he had praised as evil, stylish, and fatalistic, that it nevertheless remains popular. It has the stylishness of a race, not of an individual. If anything, he understated the stylishness of Bizet's masterpiece, for where Carmen becomes entangled in the world of operetta without ever being noted forgetting the need for a certain compositional selectivity, its active condescension takes place in the name of style as the foil to a gravity that has no need of exaggeration, because the slightest change of tone towards the frivolous alters the horizon of the music. It is presumably this procedure and not the influence of more modern composers that inspired Adrian Leverkun in his belief that dissonance should express the exalted and the spiritual, while hell is reserved for the banal and commonplace world of harmony and totality. Fate sounds not like fate, but reminds us instead of the little girl in the red dress with the tambourine at the Shrovetide Carnival children's party. Fate is expressionless. It is as cold and alien as the stars into whose galactic configurations men project the entanglements which they subconsciously create themselves. Fate is reification to the nth degree. So reification is something that we'll talk about in a couple of weeks. It's the breaking of the Kantian notion of the object that the subject constructs to a thing outside of the subject. So it's thingification. Reification to the nth degree in any music that borrows its voice must transform itself into a thing instead of behaving like the human essence before whose claims fate must retreat. Just as Frasquita and Mercedes warble soullessly when, as the French text claims, they clamor to hear news of the future, as if it were to be found in the tabloid press, so true is Adrian lacking in soul when he turns himself into a victim by imitating the voice which is not God's. But when finally the two mythic supporting figures in Act 4 vainly warn the heroine of impending doom, the music achieves a climax of sensual impassiveness with the aid of a pair of flutes playing in thirds of the kind so sparingly used by the later Wagner, an extreme antithesis to that magnificently evocative dissonance with which the Rhine maidens gave Siegfried his last chance, likewise in vain. That's from the Ring Cycle. The opera Carmen contains a stratum where brightness and destruction meet, where an emphatic superficial gloss coincides with the subliminal. The spiritual complexity of the stratum is scarcely ever matched by the much greater technical complexity of Wagner's expressive music. The theme of the great ballet music, and above all the enigmatic intermezzo after Act Two, can be assigned to this stratum. This quality of profound frivolity, of illusion, which is none, may have its roots in the fact that fate itself, the myth, is merely an illusion, and as ephemeral as the power of the Sphinx, which plunges into the abyss on hearing the name of man. Here's Nietzsche about Carmen. It constructs, organizes, and reaches a conclusion. It thereby forms a contrast to that musical polyp, the unending melody. And about the card song where she's learning her fate. Carmen begins to sing. Her aria is no song of fate, but the individual subject's response to fate, and as such is the first expressive passage in the whole trio. Despite such lyrical expressiveness, there is scarcely anything in opera with such classical grandeur, not so much according to the yardsticks of neoclassicism and culture, but in words and gestures, which are as substantial today as ever. Classical grandeur survives even today in the Romance nations in an almost physical way. It has migrated into the objective spirit of their peoples. Their experience with the menacing forces at work in the world is so great that they can allow themselves to be Christianized without abandoning that paganism, which consisted of a synthesis of mythology and skepticism. So it's one of these Greek words. I don't remember what word that is. They possess that moderation of expression in which the anti-mimetic imperative of civilization joined forces with the sullen despair, which has ceased to look to the expression of suffering to provide any easing of the pain, and which does justice to pain, to an irreversible enslavement by nature, only through such a renunciation. It is this moderation that can be learned from the gypsy song, whose mere existence tells us more about the wisdom of Aristotle and the Stoics than the summae of high scholasticism and the proud systems of philosophy. If the cards had turned out in her favor, she would have shuffled them undaunted, just as it is now all pain when they point to when they point to our death. And this possibility is indicated as the harmonies cheer up towards a cadence in the major, but still with such restraint and such absence of exuberance as if good fortune were something to be meted out like death itself. To Carmen's myth-ridden mind, there are the two pans on the scales, and no premonition promises her that luck could be part of a different scheme of things. However, this helps the singer's staying power. Only now does the lament intensify, led by a chromatic middle part, and extremely slowly in fits and starts, which like a controlled sexuality, recoil from any premature climax. Only with the second phrase does a crescendo begin, leading to a fortissimo on the inversion of the subdominant, but without much ostentation and harmonic illumination, just following where the voice leads and then breaking down swiftly. There is no reprise. Instead, after the tonic F has been reached again, a kind of shoulder-shrugging coda, there is a series of brief confirmatory interjections together with ornamental appoggiaturas, which treat fate as if nothing were more involved than the interplay of diamonds and spades. No sooner has Carmen fallen silent than we experience one of the greatest moments in all dramatic music, one of those for whose sake the entire opera form might have been invented. A moment that rivals in dignity the epilogue following the Countess's words of forgiveness in Figaro, and the Fidelio fanfare which can penetrate even prison dungeons. But in the disenchanted world which in Carmen suddenly reveals its elective affinity with the myth, which is not discussed in so many words, this moment forms the extreme antithesis to the caesura set by the humane. Announced by no more than a dominant preparation of two bars, the two operetta norns cut off their sister's dirge and strike up their unproblematic refrain. The imminence of fate, which subdues the outburst of pain and refuses to grant it an outlet, becomes an imminence of form, a rondo, a round, the circle in which the beginning and the end are one. Carmen does not stand aloof, and she sings of her own death in the low register of her mezzo-soprano. However, she does not sing in antiphonally contrasting phrases, but purely as an addition to the part writing, a complicit counterpoint. In myth, death enters the same realm as the living, without any claim to distinctiveness. The music then sets off once more, the three of them come together harmoniously, the leitmotif disappears discreetly in the bass, and the scene ends with the most ordinary F major in the world, an F major without cadential force, which is reached by a plagal inflection, which frivolously rubs shoulders with the minor origins of the piece. In the card trio, as in Carmen as a whole, there is an absence of transcendence and meaning. Indeed, both are ruled out by an overall conception which could be called positivistic, with much the same validity as the term would have if applied to Madame Bovary. The fate which rules and which nothing can halt is the primeval and pre-intellectual force of sexuality itself. Human beings are presented as pure creatures of nature, determined by something quite foreign and external. Since they are just mere existence, they are quite alien and incomprehensible to themselves. At the end, Don Jose, the culprit, literally does not know what he has done. Nietzsche undoubtedly had an ear for the love which was translated back into nature and Carmen. This is Nietzsche. Love as fate, as fatality, cynical, innocent, and cruel, and natural for that very reason. Love whose methods are those of war, and whose basis is the mortal hatred between the sexes. I know of no instance where the tragic wit, which constitutes the nature of love, is so sternly expressed, where its horror is so succinctly formulated, as in does Don Jose's last cry, the cry with which the play closes, "Yes, I have killed her. I, my adored Carmen." The contrast with Wagner, which according to the trite opinion induced Nietzsche to champion Bizet, is truly perfect. In Wagner, everything, every sentence, every gesture, every motif, and the overall interconnections are all charged with meaning. In Bizet, the inhumanity and hardness, even the violence of the form, has been used to obliterate the last token of meaning, so as to forestall any illusion that anything in life could have any meaning over and above its obvious one. According to the idea of good fortune, which is sacred to his music, the cardinal sin would be the lie that good fortune and happiness is available here and now. In this respect, Carmen, which cannot be accused of harboring ascetic ideals, is more ascetic than any of Wagner's renunciation. And the limpidezza, the clean, transparent air which so delighted Nietzsche, that refreshing absence of every ornamental excess, is the fruit of that asceticism. All right, so let's unpack that. what he got to there about the aestheticism. So basically, Wagner makes everything meaningful, makes everything significant. Everything is sort of weighed down with
kind of profound truth.
In the Carmen, in Bizet, everything is sort of matter of fact, meaning nothing has a kind of profound meaning. It just means plainly what it means. It has a deeper significance than what it is. So there's no mystery to the meaning. The mystery would be not in the art, but it would be in life itself. Whereas Wagner basically sets up his profound music and profound art in contrast to the banality of life. That might be another way in which to get back to the notes that I had for this week, the question that you posed about the comedy, right? It's ironic that Nietzsche calls Wagner a comedian or a modern comedian, because of course he's the opposite of comedy. So comedy would be things being plainly what they are, whereas for Wagner everything has a kind of a allegorical or metaphorical significance, a kind of profound truth that's different from what it is. So then why would he be the modern comedian? Well, it's in the music rather than in the story. It's in the music rather than the story. So it's what we were talking about earlier in class, which is that Wagner's music, despite himself, he's trying to create some profound, spiritual, mysterious music. Actually, what it is a kind of plain expression of where music is in the 19th century. So, and then it's sort of hidden behind the mythological story in the play. So that contrast. So it's almost as if he's trying to hide the meaning of the music behind the drama. Now, would the reverse be true? Is he hiding the drama behind the music? That would also be the case. But we'll see in a slightly different way. So, music becomes only the signified, the form and structure go to the background. Right, so it just becomes, you know, its own, what is it that Adorno said? The essence and appearance are separated in Wagner, whereas they're the same thing in the Bizet. They're not separated, they're the same thing. And that's what it means to say that the idea prevails. In other words, we're supposed to think about the profound idea behind the music, rather than the music itself. Or the profound idea behind the drama, rather than the drama itself. That would also apply there. Right, music is the means. It's like a vehicle for concepts and ideas, which means that the music is being rendered secondary rather than primary. I mean, potentially, right, so Nietzsche's point is that potentially Wagner could be an occasion for thinking. So Wagner's music tries to avoid that, but could nonetheless become that. And that's where actually Nietzsche's own writing about Wagner becomes necessary. So if we go back to the Hegel, why Hegel thought that criticism, theory, philosophizing about art is necessary. It's to sort of, you know, bring out, make explicit the thoughts that otherwise might be provoked by the art, but might also sort of escape the listener in this case, or the viewer. So, I think that we read this early on in the preface. So think, but not necessarily critically. Actually, there's a collection of Wagner's writings, Music and Revolution. Music and Revolution. So again, that would be the 1848 character of Wagner, where he connected politics and art in this way, that he wanted to be a revolutionary in music, and he thought that that meant being a political revolutionary also, right. So the question for Nietzsche then is, well, what kind of revolution? Meaning, okay, Wagner's a revolutionary, but then the question is, what kind of revolution? What's the content of that revolution?
Well, he also says he drifts to Schopenhauerian pessimism, right away from his radicalism of the 1840s.
Mm-hmm. Wagner. Yeah, Wagner did. So Schopenhauer is a contemporary of Hegel, and he's the kind of great philosophical antagonist to Hegel, who tried to distinguish between Kant and Hegel. You know, he says Kant's a great philosopher, Hegel's not even a philosopher. That's like Schopenhauer's idea. So what's significant about that, especially we'll see in the Adorno piece, is Schopenhauer didn't like Hegel's dialectical philosophy. He thought that it wasn't like really philosophy, but it was a kind of hocus pocus. It was a kind of sophistry, essentially. Now, but let's think about the connection between Schopenhauer and 1848, because it's there in the Nietzsche. So decadence, meaning what is the result of revolution? Revolution is supposed to bring about a renewal, like the revolutionaries want to kind of have a rebirth through the revolution. What actually results from the revolution, however, is decadence. Now, what is decadence? Decline, decay, right? The sort of the loss of civilizational greatness. So what would that mean in the realm of music? Right, so to be a political revolutionary means to kind of ruin a civilization. To be a revolutionary in art also means the ruination of art. But not a mere destruction, but rather a decadence. So a decadence means something that can be used to express a symptom, and even, you know, as we were talking about earlier, provide a diagnosis. What else might you want to say about that last line about the mass deleting authenticity and criticism and orienting itself in only one direction?
I think what I got from the text is that, so from this decadence, it's like, so basically you have the Wagnerians, which is like the big fan base of Wagner, from my understanding.
Mm-hmm.
And these people, these Wagnerians, they corrupt the mass by saying that, oh, Wagner is kind of like the new god in music, and by doing that they delete the authenticity because they delete the criticism, because everyone starts to think that Wagner is indeed the new god, and in that sense, like any other creation that's different from Wagner is considered as opposite or not even good.
Inauthentic, right?
Yeah, inauthentic.
Right. Okay, so here's the strange thought figure that Nietzsche is trying to introduce. So Nietzsche is saying that the Wagnerians remove themselves from the decadent masses, right? So they sort of set themselves apart. Again, it comes out of Bohemia. But in fact, what they do is exemplify the corrupt masses. So they think of themselves as fleeing the corruption of society, but actually they exemplify it. And they exemplify it like especially so. And so how do they do so? Precisely by distinguishing themselves from the mass. In other words, in distinguishing themselves from the corruption of the masses, actually they are doing it even more so than the masses themselves. So why is that important? Because from the Wagnerian, we could say, standpoint, Carmen in Bizet, it's popular opera, so would just be seen as like commercial music, that is just playing to the corruption of the masses, right? That they are doing the opposite of that, right? They're doing something that can't be appreciated by the masses, can't be commercialized in that way, right? It's only for a certain special elect, like self-selected group of initiates to appreciate. But in fact, what they're doing is a sort of even worse version, right? So whereas it's precisely the popularity of Bizet that might redeem Bizet. Right? So really the category is modernity, right? The Baudelaire term, what Baudelaire coins, the neologism, modernity. So what is, that's the, really the question, what is the significance of modernity? What does modernity mean? And what does modernity have as a value? All right, so let's think about it very basically. Like, there's a paradox here. How could the value of something be decadence? How could the value of something be corruption? Because when we think of like decadence and corruption, we're thinking of a loss of value. And that actually goes to the heart of what, of how Baudelaire defined it. So for the Romantics, the idea is that there was a loss of value, like art lost its value. And then Baudelaire said, no, it's not a loss of value, it's a gain of a new value, right? So again, there is a change registered, and it's only the question of the value of that change. Because Baudelaire actually did not claim that this was an improvement over classicism, right? So modernism, modernity, is not like better than classicism, but, and it might indeed be, because according to Baudelaire himself, it might indeed be a decadent value, but it was the true value nonetheless, right? So basically, Baudelaire embraced it, whereas Wagner and the Wagnerians reject it. Right, so it's not a matter of resisting the change or regretting the change or treating the change as the loss, but rather treating the change as authentic. That's really the question. So the Wagnerians, in rejecting the authenticity of modernity in favor of like their true authenticity, like the authentic music, Wagner, actually what they were confessing was their inauthenticity, right? So Carmen is the authentic modern, and Wagner, by rejecting modernity, is actually still modern, but in an inauthentic way, right? These are the sort of, would you call it a dialectical reversal? Not exactly. It's more like a kind of, irony, yeah, it's a kind of ironical reversal, right? That it's precisely in resisting modernity that Wagner is inauthentic, but also authentic, right? Because part of modernity is the rejection of modernity. So if you recall from the Robert Pippin from the first day of class, the recoil against modernity, right? So the romantic recoil against modernity. The recoil against modernity is part of modernity.
It's part of modernity. Now, when we were just reading about Carmen from Adorno, so what does the gypsy represent? So she's the factory worker, so she's in modern life, but she's also outside of modern life. So she represents like the sort of unintegrated, culturally unassimilated, unassimilable outsider, right, the sort of primitive, the kind of pre-modern, and yet she's exactly in the center of the modern world. Right, so in other words, by representing something outside of modernity, she exemplifies modernity.
One way of thinking... Sorry, true authenticity?
Well, that's it, exactly. In other words, she's authentic, but she's also inauthentic, right? So,
meaning she's authentic in the sense of she's not like a kind of a decadent French person, but she's like a kind of authentic Mediterranean person. It's really the question of primitivism. So primitivism really starts with modernism. Like, you don't get primitivism as a value, as an aesthetic value, or as a cultural value until you have modernism. So modernism and primitivism are really conjoined, right? So primitivism is modernism, even though it represents a kind of rejection of modernity. Right, so who's the famous, infamous?
Picasso.
Well, there's Picasso, but who's the guy who goes to Tahiti? Boy, I'm forgetting it.
Gauguin.
Gauguin. Right, Gauguin. Right, so Gauguin is like, you know, leaves Paris and he goes to Normandy and he's like, okay, these are like
awesome.
The true, like, French peasants, right, who are still living the old way, right? And then he's like, oh, but, you know, I have to go even further than that. And so he goes all the way to the South Pacific, right? And yet the whole imagination of the primitive is modernist, right? It's actually exactly modernist. Because before that, it wouldn't have occurred to anyone to look at things that way, right? Actually, before modernism, you would have had a different kind of bourgeois universalism. You would have not had kind of primitivism. You would have had rather the noble savage. You would have had something else. Also, that the goal of like renewing civilization would be to like return to like a more natural condition, even if in a modern way, as opposed to this kind of flat opposition of the modern and the primitive. Right. So in modernism and primitivism, are really inseparable. And also as an outgrowth of Romanticism. Right? Even though the Romantics themselves wouldn't have looked at it that way. Because it wouldn't have been like nature versus society. Now that's where the gypsy in particular, like gypsies, they represent something very specific. So they're the sort of permanent outsiders. And again, like, why are they called gypsies? Because they're seen as coming from like the Eastern Mediterranean world. Actually, what they are is from South Asia. And actually the word gypsy is like wrong. It's the Roma, right? But they are, you know, they exclude themselves from civilization, but they also live in the heart of civilization. So they're sort of there in the city, but they're also outside of the community. Right, so the way that Bizet is thematizing it in terms of the industrial proletariat, like the factory worker, is that the factory workers are precisely the newly arrived people in the city rather than the traditional artisans. So the bourgeois artisans are not the factory workers, right? Because they're too good to work in the factory because they're still the skilled artisan workers. Whereas the people who come out of abject economic necessity can be exploited by industry and work in the factory, right? So that's the significance of Carmen being a cigarette factory worker. It should also be pointed out that industrial production, industrial-like factories, disproportionately employed women and children rather than men in the early 19th century.
So like little known facts at this point, but would have been obvious to contemporaries. So again, what does that mean? Like the factory is obviously modernity
in a way that the artisanal laborer is not modernity. Right, so the fact that the factory is modernity, but it employs the people from the country who are the primitives, right, that's the connection.
All right, sorry to hold us over a little bit late. So next week is Lukács, if I'm not mistaken, Lukács, The Theory of the Novel. Anyone want to take a stab at the Lukács? You two? You guys? You guys? Okay, great. All right, excellent. All right, I will see you guys next week.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah.